Good evening. Welcome to the Diversity of Wire Division. I'm Joseph Amprey, and I'm excited about tonight's program. I've entitled this program, Iron Sharpens Iron. That title is designating the fact that there are so many negative images of blacks and Hispanics in the urban areas. And tonight we have people who are breaking down those images, showing you positive images, and I'm excited about the fact that they're here. I'm going to introduce each guest individually, and I'll come back and have them talk about what they're doing in such a positive way. To my immediate left is Mr. Ed Terrell, an artist, well-known artist in the community. Ed, thanks for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Amprey. It's always good to be here.
Ed's going to show you his art, but just as important as the tremendous art he does, Ed has promoted so many young artists, and some of them are here tonight. Next to Ed is a young man named Jafet, Jaime. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
You are a student at ILEAD?
ILEAD Charter School, yeah.
What grade are you in?
10th grade, sophomore.
Well, we're going to look at some of your art, too, tonight. Okay, thanks
awesome.
For coming.
Thanks.
Next to Jaime is Kendrick, Dewayne.
Hello.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
You're an artist. And what is your medium for the most part?
I use a mixture of acrylic, spray paint, and oils.
Okay. Well, we're going to look at some of your art tonight. We also have Mike Melendez, who trains boxers at the East Reading Boxing Club.
That's correct. Thank you for having me, Doc.
And thanks for coming, because a lot of young men have something to do to be positive and to look forward to.
Absolutely.
Last but not least is Dr. James Jackson. Good evening. Thanks for coming.
Hello. How are you?
He's actually the Reverend Dr. James Jackson. He has two dynamic roles. He is a professor at Kutztown University. He's also the pastor of Goodman Memorial Baptist Church in Harrisburg. And he's going to talk about his research about black fathers. Ed, let's talk about some of your art. What do you have here tonight?
Well, I have this one piece here in the center here. It's a combination of a mixed media, whereby you take various different materials and you mix them together and you come out with a finished product. It's a three-dimensional piece, whereby it's made out of paper mache that takes on the shape of a human face, but then it's kind of improvised, abstract, that there's colors and shapes, objects, and imagery in there. I used to just be a mask maker. And once I was making masks, and I needed a place to lay the mask down, and I just laid it on a painting, and I realized that I could infuse my mask making into a piece of canvas work or artwork, such as you see before you now. I call this one inner vision. We see many people with faces, but inside of them there's other masks and things that they wear that makes them who they are in real life. That's why I call it inner vision.
There's some other art here that you've produced also, I guess we can scan the room. Where are...
I just bought one piece tonight I wanted the other artists to have space of promoting their art. Art is a very important media in any culture and society, because it brings about beauty and attribute to places that are drab and dreary.
Okay. Jafet, you're 17. How long have you been producing art?
My whole life.
Your whole life?
Yes.
And where are your productions here tonight?
I have two right there.
On the easel.
I've got another one over here.
Okay.
And then one right in back of me.
Do you do watercolor, or do you do, what's your main medium that you like to use?
Acrylic.
Acrylic.
Acrylic paint, yes.
Okay. So Ed has influenced you. Ed, would you say acrylic is harder than watercolor? Is it more difficult, do you think?
No, it's the opposite. Watercolor is kind of hard. I thought you were comparing it to oil.
Uh-huh.
The hardest one is oil because
uh-huh.
it has a very oily base to it, and it takes a long time for it to dry.
Uh-huh.
And the reason why I personally am attracted to the acrylic, because I'm a commercial artist,
uh-huh.
and I mean that I'm in business. And so I need a material that can dry quickly and that I can move my product on the market to sell it.
Uh-huh.
This is why I paint in acrylic, because it dries quickly. It dries within the hour.
So it's faster.
It's faster.
Okay. Now, Kendrick, you have some material here also. Is the one on your right over your shoulder one of yours? Is that one of yours?
No, this is Jafet's.
Jafet's, okay. And you also are right out in front here, I guess.
Yes, I have the three in front.
Okay. How long have you been doing this?
I've been painting basically all my life as well.
Uh-huh.
Well, drawing.
Uh-huh.
And then I started painting a little later.
Yeah. I guess Ed has influenced him. One thing that Ed has done well is he's been able to market himself. there are so many talented artists who have to do something else. They would love to be creating all the time, but unfortunately they have to market their material and sometimes they don't sell enough. But Ed, you have been able to live well on your creations. And I guess it's about marketing, I guess.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Amprey. Yes, it's 100% or 90% marketing, how you have a product and you can put it on the market for sale, but where's the medium and the outlet for that? So I use a lot of social media. I have about 3 websites. One I have is ZYX Art by Terrell. That's on Facebook. And I have another one that's called Spiritual Sky Art by Terrell. It's on Facebook also. And people inbox me if they like my art. Sometimes I get like 2 or 3 hits a night on people wanting some of my material. And I also do community murals. I do community workshops with kids. And this up and coming week, we're going to have an opening for Jafet at Mi Casa Su Casa at 320 Penn Street here in Reading, Pennsylvania. It's a fundraiser. We're doing an exhibit together. The both of us are showing our art together. And maybe Jafet would like to speak about that because it's his dream.
You're going to have a lot of things there?
Yeah.
They're probably going to put up the date and time of the Wednesday exhibition that you guys have, and they'll put that up in a few minutes. So you can see it there now. Thank you so much for putting that up and at Mi Casa Su Casa, and this is Wednesday. And so if you want to come by and see their materials, feel free. Also, we're on the air. We're live on Monday the 11th. We'll be on the air until about 10 minutes to 9. If you have any questions, you can call us at 610-378-0426. Again, that's 610-378-0426. Last Saturday night, Manny Pacquiao boxed again. Many of us boxing fans last May 2nd were looking forward to what we thought would be the fight of the century, and we were disappointed. Unfortunately, he was hurt. I don't know if he and Mayweather will box again, but we never know. But importantly, Mike, is that we have an East Reading Boxing Club, and you've been involved there with young men.
And women.
And women. Thanks. How many women do you have? You have quite a few?
Yeah, there's a few girls there now. Uh-huh. Yes, there is.
That's good, because we believe that young people who are involved with some kind of activity that they enjoy can produce careers, can be active. We think that idleness can be a problem for many of our youth today, and especially for boxing. There are many Hispanic young men there who are boxing. How long have you been there?
I've been there for going on 2 years now.
And I guess you were a boxer yourself at one time.
I boxed when I was 8 till I was 17, and then I had to go get a real job. Uh-huh. unfortunately, I couldn't get licensed because my eyesight wasn't that good. Now they have LASIK vision, and you can get surgeries done, and you can get your eyes. If they would have had that back then, I probably would have became professional.
Yeah. I'm always fascinated about the weight issue. Most boxers and wrestlers seem to box or perform at a weight less than the one they walk around in.
Of course.
And tell us, what is the reason for that?
Well, because you're stronger at the weight you walk around in, but you drop weight in order to make weight. Therefore, when you do go in the ring, you go in a little heavier than when you're comfortable weight.
Uh-huh.
So everybody wants to drop weight. And then, the night of the fight, they're at their walk-around weight.
And I'm also impressed with the discipline involved, because oftentimes, we love to eat. But most young people who are involved in boxing or wrestling have to learn to maintain a certain weight.
Absolutely. In today's society, we have a huge problem with obesity. And our kids are sitting in front of the television, absorbing all these sugars and not doing enough exercise. And boxing's a good medium to get out there and really thrive and get your body moving and get it in shape.
I guess a major question we need to put forth is if young people are interested in getting involved, is there a number they can call? And where are you located?
Well, you can look us up on Facebook, East Reading Boxing Club. We're located at 17th and Cotton Street in Reading. The phone number's changed a few times, so I would think your best bet to probably get a hold of us is just stop in at 17th and Cotton, or you can just look us up on Facebook.
Well, anyway, you keep lots of folks out of trouble.
Absolutely.
And doing positive things. And the thing I've liked, because they've been on this program many times, is that they're also involved in making sure they do well in school.
Absolutely.
That they teach values.
If one of our kids get in trouble in school, whether, say, for example, they would be suspended or something, they would suffer the same consequence in the gym, and then they would be punished in the gym. It teaches them values, and it teaches them, hey, look, I better be doing good in school, otherwise I can't, you know, go do what I love to do. Most of these kids are there because they love to be there. I mean, this is like a second home to them. So they show up, and you pretty much have to, you know, kick them out when the classes are done. You guys got to go home now. Otherwise, they'd stay there 3-4 hours a day easily.
Yeah. I'm going to go back to Ed, to Jafet, and to Kendrick, and talk about when you create. Do you create while you're playing music? Do you create at a certain time? For example, Jafet, when do you like to do your artwork?
When I'm doing my artwork, I usually tend to listen to music. Gives me, I guess, more inspiration, motivation to create what I want to create.
And are you almost in a zone, where almost like you're, I don't know, I hate to call it flow, and you're just happy you're doing it?
Yeah, kind of. You're like, you just want to create, and you're in the flow of painting.
Now, do you draw it first and then paint it, or does it depend?
No, when I paint, I just paint.
Paint.
That's the flow. That's why I listen to music. I just go with the flow. That's why.
What about you, Kendrick? When you're painting, are you listening to music at the same time? Are you creating? You draw it first. How do you go about the process?
Usually, I'm listening to music, dancing around, being wild. Uh-huh. I'm alone, so there's no embarrassing.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's a process, kind of like meditation.
It's therapeutic.
It's therapeutic.
I had a friend once who was an artist who told me that he had a regular job during the week. But he said on Friday, about 9 o'clock, he would have his music going, a few drinks, and he could paint all night. He said he was just he would paint, you know, just, and there's something about when you're in your world, it's therapeutic.
Yeah.
And I was always fascinated with that. I guess that's true for boxers too. I guess when you're working out and getting ready.
You're in a zone. You do. We play. Of course, we listen to music as well.
Uh-huh.
We have the music blasting. The kids are into their groove. And boxing's a form of art. I mean, uh-huh. There's a science behind it. You just don't go in there and throw punches like crazy.
Uh-huh.
There's footwork involved. There's preparation involved. Depending on who's in front of you in the ring, you have to come up with a game plan to surpass your opponent's game plan. It's a chess game. There's a lot involved in boxing. It's just not a fact of two people just smashing each other. That's not even what boxing's about.
And it's about styles, whether you are a puncher or a boxer.
Exactly. That's what makes styles make fights, of course.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Bradley versus Pacquiao, was that a battle styles also, would you say?
It's always going to be. I mean, you have a puncher against the boxer, just like, you know, everybody complains about how Mayweather's running. That's Mayweather's game plan. You got to chase him. If you can cut off the ring, then you get then you get your punches in. If you can't hit him, then it's your problem. You come up with another game plan.
Uh-huh.
I mean, at the end of the day, it's one game plan against another.
Now, I'm going to give you a woulda, shoulda, coulda question.
Uh-huh.
Most people thought that if Mayweather had boxed Pacquiao 5 years ago,
it could have been a different story.
It would have been a different fight.
It could have been a different story. Or it could have been the same story. Who would know? You never know.
Yeah. And I talked to lots of boxing aficionados who said before the fight that they thought that Mayweather could not outdance, could run from Pacquiao for 15 rounds or 12 rounds.
I think back in the day, Mayweather wouldn't try. I think back in the day when Mayweather was hungry, he would stand and take chances.
Mm-hmm.
And he would fight, he would stand and take chances against other fighters.
Uh-huh.
And that would allow them to get their punches in. I think as Mayweather went on to become, invincible and undefeated, he started saying, hey, why am I taking all these punches?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where he developed this, come and get me.
Uh-huh.
Attitude, and you had to go get him.
Yeah. And one of the questions now is whether he will stay retired.
I doubt it. For the right amount of money, you'll get half these guys back. Ray Mercer wants to get back in the ring. You got guys who've been retired for 20 years that want to fight again.
Uh-huh.
It's once it's in your blood, it just stays there.
Yeah, almost any athlete, you just enjoy it so much.
Exactly. Uh-huh. You enjoy it so much that if you can keep doing it or you believe that you can keep doing it, you'll always want to be out there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm happy that you gentlemen are here because we have youth who need something to do, something to be productive, whether it's art or boxing. And of course, Jafet, you're a role model for us. You know, we're hoping that some young people look at you saying, wow, he's got material there. I want to be like him. And of course, you go to ILEE, which is a school which we're very proud of also. Dr. James Jackson, the Reverend Dr. James Jackson, has done some research, which I think is so important for this program. I call this show Iron Sharpening Iron. And I said this because I know that he has, for about 8 years, been looking at fatherhood amongst black males. Yep. And all too often, we have been seen as negligent. And I must say, I'm very happy to father and a grandfather, and I enjoy being with my children and trying to be a role model, but Dr. Jackson has taken another step. He has actually looked at a series of fathers' styles over a period of time. Okay. Tell us a little bit about your research, if you would.
Starting at about 8 years ago, we were fascinated with a book that on black families. And it was 2002, and the author is Cohen. And the research that he was presenting basically said that there was lots of positive things out there that the black family was doing, but that no one was talking about them. And he said that most of the research out there showed negative aspects of parenting from black families, and that the positive aspects were being overlooked. So we started a project called Black Positive Fatherhood, and the main goal was to find out what black fathers did in terms of their positive pedagogy when parenting. Simply put, what do black men do right when they're fathering? We didn't care about the negative, we just simply wanted those particular traits. So we started collecting data. We started looking at an age group from 18 to actually 92. And we wanted to find out, the first question was real simple. What is it that black fathers do, right? And then we started looking at women, right? What's the difference between black women and their image of a black father and black males and their image of black fathering? And then we looked at young versus old and then a number of different traits. And from that research, a lot of positive things fell out. We came up with about 10 positive traits overall that black males do while they are fathering their children. And we looked at it from a historical perspective on how those 10 traits have changed over time. So we started going back as far as Reconstruction, right? Well, we started from slavery. And we looked at the period from slavery to Reconstruction, from Reconstruction to the New Deal, from the New Deal to what we call the Power 70s, and then from the Power 70s to the day. And what we find that when we look at that the image of black fathering has changed over time, and what fathers do within that construct change over time. And so we've identified two overall models in which black fathers use, one called an instructional model and one called an example model. And we've identified that in some cases the images of, again, what black females think that a black father should be doing is sometimes different from what a black male think a black father should be doing. And so there's a conflict there. So where do you want to start?
Well, we talked about this off the air, and I was fascinated about the fact that there are different approaches.
Correct.
Fathers actually set an example. Mm-hmm. Others show. Than what they would like to do. And I guess my dad did a little bit of both. When it came to schoolwork, he showed me what I should be doing. And then when it came to sports, he also. But he was also, I thought, a powerful role model in terms of always providing for the family, being a role model, active in his church, also mentoring other kids in the neighborhood.
Sure.
You know, everybody wanted to play ball with him because he is a former athlete. So I think that you can be a role model who actually shows kids how to do things, right, or you can be a person who sets an example by your behavior.
And what we found was older adults or older black males, say from 92 to like down to about 65, their thoughts of how their fathers did things were different. And so those particular fathers were more instructional fathers. So when you ask those men, what did you learn from your father? They say things like, I learned how to plant a garden. I learned how to change a tire. I learned how to I work on a car. I learned how to balance my checkbook, right? I learned how to, paint a wall. I learned how to do drywall. There were these kind of instructional things that a father had to take their son or children through when they were doing it. And then starting somewhere around the 1960s, so that later part of the baby boomer generation and forward, it turned into examples. So then fathers became less interactive with their kids, but still active with their kids. So fathers would set the example, I want to be a good role model for my children. So when you ask those questions, they'd say, well, my father taught me to, you know, because I saw him get up and go to work every day. I saw my father treat my mother well. I saw how my father interacted with church. I saw how my father dealt with his friends. And so it was leading by example. And that was fascinating. And then when you move into kind of the modern era of how black males tend to father, it seems to be going back to a mixture of both, right? Because our times have changed. When fathers were leading their children by example, it was a different era. It was fathers needed to teach their children how to survive. So we were in Jim Crow, we were under segregation, and there was a certain set of social rules that you had to teach your children in order for them to be safe, right? And then during the 70s and the 80s, when more opportunities came open and blacks had started to integrate into white America, then the example had to be set, right? So there was a certain way you need to behave in this situation, and there's a certain way that you need to behave in this situation. So you would, so a son or a daughter would see their father acting one way in a professional setting, and then come around their friends, and we called it, you know, flip mode, and then turn and be something else. And so they'd hear father talking one way to his boss on the phone, hang up the phone, and have a completely different mannerism about themselves, right? And so there was this this form of teaching self-control and by example of how to succeed, and that took some time to learn.
Well, let me say this. I know you've done some fantastic research, and I'm happy to hear about it, but I also want to share with the audience that I've known Dr. Jackson for about 10 years, and I've seen him be a phenomenal role model as a professor.
Thank you.
As a matter of fact, I use some of his internet sources and his textbook. So he is a phenomenal teacher who really motivates people as a role model at the school. He's also been an advisor for members of our fraternity. He's also a pastor, and he has to be a role model of church. So thank you for doing this research, but I also want to thank you for the role model you've been, and I've watched you for lots of people and lots of places.
Thank you.
That's awfully exciting in terms of being a role model. And he surprised me. He came here with his kids tonight. You know, they're actually watching Dad put together a TV program.
Thank you.
But that's true of all the people here, especially Mike and especially Ed. And I'm going to say it again. Ed produces, but Ed has mentored lots of young artists and helped them, shown them how to market their art. And so I appreciate that more than anything else. Jafet, I'm hoping that that'll be something you'll do later on. Right now, you got to do your own thing and develop your own material. But I'm hoping that'll be something you can do in terms of promoting others. Again, if you have questions, feel free to give us a call.
He's trying to start a youth center that he should talk about. He's trying to open up a center, Jafet.
Let me put you on the spot, Dr. Jackson, because you're a pastor.
Yes, Sam.
And one of the challenges that I face and wanting to be a scholar is sometimes you're seen as if you are a scholar or a pastor, you might be seen as not being macho enough. That did you ever run into any challenges if you were coming along, you know, getting a PhD, doing work in theology, being the scholar? Did you ever get challenged because sometimes we look at the scholarly guy as not it's not the tough guy?
And again, thank you for bringing that out. One of the 10 traits that came out of our research was that of masculinity. Fathers teach and model, you know, in some particular cases, positive fatherhood, what it is to be masculine. to say, no, I didn't, because my father was a scholar, right? Mm-hmm. And he also was a pastor. And the way he carried himself said that he was in control, he should be respected, and that the one of the things he taught me was if you want respect, you must give respect, and in certain cases, you have to demand respect. And in demanding of that respect, you do it because of where you are and your position and where you're going. So, was I a nerd? Yeah, probably. Was I a cool nerd? Yeah, probably. But in that, you carry yourself in a certain way, and I learned that from my father.
The other example is Mike Melendez. Mike, you're a boxer.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm sure there's some young guys who box because they can defend themselves.
Right.
And one of the nice things about being able to, the sweet science is that they're bullies out there.
A lot of bullies out there. Most of the kids that come into our gym really don't know how to fight. Mm. Most of the kids that come into our gym is because they want to learn how to defend themselves. So we teach them how to defend themselves so they don't have to fight. And that's it. When you carry yourself, as the professor said, if you carry yourself in a certain way where you have confidence in yourself and to be able to defend yourself, it's an aura about you where other people will catch on to and they will respect that. Mm. You know, you're always going to have those guys who still want to push your buttons and see how far they can get you. Mm. And this is where a lot of the discipline comes in. And we tell our kids, don't you be the first one to throw the punch. Always be in control of your emotions and your anger. Be in control of all your surroundings. Be alert at what's going on around you. All these things alert in boxing. Just like in life, little things happen in life that teaches you different things that you pick up on. Mm-hmm. Boxing's the same way. It's no different.
One of the things I regret personally is that I think as a teenager, I ran from art because it wasn't macho enough. And as I got older, I regretted it because I think that a lot of the skills that these three gentlemen have, you developed at an early age. And I think had I not been running from art, maybe I would have been more talented with music and art. But I also think that you can be an artist and be a man and be a macho man. But I think that all too often, and I saw my son do the same thing. Sometimes we run from art and music and drama and theater, and we shouldn't. Because they require discipline, they require skill. And I think it all too often, I'm glad you guys didn't, and I'm glad you didn't. But I'm sorry that I did as I look back on how we handle these kinds of things. Because I think they play a very important part in our lives and what we do. And then develop the skills. And if you have a skill, you can be talented. A comment.
I want to say that in today's society and how we're developing and how our mindset is, it's kind of backwards. Artists and performers are the epitome of masculinity and manhood. Mm-hmm. You look at the 50 Cents, you're watching the hit show that's on Empire right now. All of these images are of entertainment and art. The show Empire is full of it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, any other genre that you see, you're going to see all these great background pieces, artists being taken away from the background and put into the foreground. Any city that you go into, a large city, you're going to see art everywhere. Whether it's going to be sculptures or murals or fountains or what is it, agriculture, plants and what you call it. And dudes do the planning of all of that stuff. So, I mean, it's there's been a flip-flop that's going on, especially with the difference my artwork. I think my artwork just impedes masculinity. I mean, I couldn't bring a lot of my stuff because my mom told me not to, but but the stuff that I did bring, I think it oozes masculinity.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, just stating that.
I'm also fascinated also that oftentimes art is multidisciplinary. For example, most boxers are also dancers. Mm-hmm. There's a certain amount of art to that. And many artists are also musicians. Now, I know that Ed is known as an artist, but I saw Ed one day out playing the bongos.
Yeah.
So, and sometimes the creativity comes in more than one discipline, which can be a blessing. Are either of you in music at any other artistic areas? Are you strictly artists?
I play drums. I usually do a drum circle once a month in the community, different places where a bunch of us get together with these drums called djembes, drums from Ghana, and we sit around and we play drums.
Yeah. Dr. Jackson is also a singer, and he always lets me know that, Joe, I don't sing and preach at the same time. He made it clear to me that he is not going to sing in the pulpit, but he is also is noted for having a singing voice. So.
But I've started to learn how to play the drums, and I'm also a third-degree black belt. You forget that, too.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah. I'm not going to mess with you, brother. I also think he made a point earlier. He didn't emphasize it, but I think I love this from my dad, is that oftentimes... when you are a scholar, you're seen as being not macho or tough enough. Right. And my dad was what I would call bicultural. Mm-hmm. If he was talking to his buddies, it's what up, blood. Mm-hmm. But if he was talking to somebody in his office, it was, how do you do, sir?
Right.
And so I think that we have to really emphasize amongst our young men that when you're in class, when you're in school, you need to speak the King's English correctly and be articulate. But it's okay to be cool when you're not there. And I love to ask the question to young people, can you be cool and a good student?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And I love it when they say yes. Because oftentimes we have seen cases where students have underachieved because they say, oh, you're trying to be white, as if being articulate is being white. Articulation comes in all races, and I hope that you're bilingual. I'm always impressed when my Hispanic brothers can handle both English and Spanish.
I when I moved to Puerto Rico, I was only 8 years of age, and all the words I would say, I had to become a boxer. Mm-hmm. I mean, the words that I knew in Spanish, you just didn't get around just saying. Uh-huh. So, but as I lived there for like 9 years, and I was around that culture, and I learned how to speak, write, read it. Now it's like, I can speak Spanish to you, and you swear that I can't speak no English. Uh-huh. I mean, it's just, that comes out that perfect.
And I'm glad to hear that. It's a blessing. A blessing you can be proud of. Mm-hmm. Well, again, gentlemen, you all play phenomenal roles. Because we have some negative images, and you help break those down. And you're also role models. And so often our young people need to know that there are certain things that are about success and about power and about doing good things. And of course, I guess in some ways I'm kind of jealous of yours, because your productions are, you can see it. Once you create a painting, it's something you can put your fingers on and show. And it exists. Although I guess there's also a certain amount of pressure, because if they do something well, what do you follow it up with? Mm. You know, and there have been people who have created masterpieces,
yes.
And they're saying, "What do you do next?" There's a very famous novel that one Invisible Man was written in the 50s, and it was a masterpiece, sold millions. And that artist, that writer, never wrote another big novel.
Yeah.
So it's always a question about what are you going to do next? And if you're creative, you'll think of something next.
Yeah.
And they say you have to let yourself go. I think that all too often, those who aren't creative don't let ourselves go. Sometimes we don't know how to develop creativity. We think in a box. And we don't ask, why must I do it that same way all the time? And I guess, Mike, in some ways, if you are training a boxer, and he's got an opponent coming up, you got to stop and think, okay, you know, he moves to his left.
You have to dissect them.
Yeah,
you know. You have to look at, and a lot of people think that you're always worried about what you, no, you have to see the opponent and see what he does and find his weaknesses, and then you have to teach a fighter to be able to identify those weaknesses. It's a chess game.
Well, I can admire the fact that you can sit down before the fight and plan, but what really would be tough for me would be, all right, we have a game plan. We're in the boxing match. And suddenly, he's doing something that I didn't expect.
Right.
And I've got to change, not next week, now.
Right. Well, it's like Mike Tyson said. I mean, everybody has a game plan until you get punched in the mouth. Mm-hmm. And then it goes out the window. Mm-hmm. And that's where the discipline comes in. You have to stay focused, and you have to stay on top of your game plan. And even if you have to deviate it a little, because you do have to adjust. I'm not saying you don't, but it's the same thing in life. I mean, you get up every morning, you go to work, you go to school, you're expecting this to happen, everything to go smoothest. One thing happens that threw you completely off course. Now you have to adjust. It's the same thing in the ring. Yeah. It's no different.
And I was surprised to learn that sometimes the most powerful punch could be 6 inches. It's something about the footwork behind it, though.
The punch that really hurts the most, you ask any boxer, is the one he don't see coming. That's the one that hurts the most.
But to an extent, you guys have brought kids here, and they have their favorite boxers, and I'm always impressed with the poise it teaches. And also, I'm still bothered by all the bullies, but most of the guys who come to your gym don't worry about getting bullied anymore.
No, they don't. And you know what? And if anybody's getting out there and they're getting bullied, speak to your parents about it. Speak to your teachers about it. Let them know what's going on, because you don't have to take it.
Dr. Jackson, I guess we can look for a book in the future.
Yes.
As a result of this.
We have Dr. Thomas Robinson and I, who's collaborating on the work. We have a few more things to do. We want to kind of look at another generation. We want to kind of come down now and look at the 8 to 16-year-olds to see what their thought about fathering is about. Well, we want to ask them a question, you know. When you become a father, you know, what is it that you will expect to interact with your children? You know, what do you want to do, and what's your idea of being a father, right? Our hopes is that if we can develop enough positive traits on the top end, that we can start teaching our smaller males of just exactly what it is they need to do. So it's not just about trying to give them all the example, but also teach them and instruct them on how to do it. When was the last time you saw an older male instruct a boy to open up the door? Right. So my 9-year-old son just went on a date, and I had him call the young girl's father to ask permission. And then he got to the movie theater early to be there to greet them. He walked around and he opened up her door, right? Thanked the father for bringing her, and then went in, and I showed him how to pay for the popcorn and the soda. He carried it for her, sat down, and it's those instructional things that I think that older gentlemen need to get back to doing. Not just saying, you know, do this, but modeling the behavior. And I think we start our kids, at least our males, at a young age of doing those particular things, then they'll learn.
One of my concerns has been the fact that in terms of church attendance, it's been my experience that young people go to church from 5 to about 12 or 13, and then many of them stop going when they become teenagers.
Okay.
And I'm always impressed with those churches that can somehow keep them. Right. And of course, I visited your church once and it was packed.
Thanks.
All ages. And I guess a lot of ministers will probably ask you, how do we keep the young people? What do we do? You know, that's probably a challenge in terms of, because I think that while I'm impressed with fatherhood, I'm also impressed with those fathers who take their young people to church.
And you bring up an interesting point, because it wasn't just taking them to church, it was you were going to. And if you take church out and you put another social activity in there that you're going to commit to doing it, right? Whether it's boys, girls, club, whether it's boxing, whether it's painting, whether it's, you know, swimming or sport, you know, the father making sure that the commitment was there and that you were going to do it. So a lot of people, a lot of church kids say that I was, you know, drug to church. Right, but it wasn't just going. The lesson was, this is something that we're committed to. This is something we're going to stay committed to. Right, and so those older fathers say that they were forced to go to church. But those were the same older gentlemen who, once they got a job, stayed at that job because they knew the ladder, you know, that this is, we commit to something. Mm-hmm. Our 13, 14, and 15-year-olds now, whether or not we give them a choice of going to church or going to be committed to something, the lesson, though, for fatherhood is teach those kids to be committed to something and stay focused on something and stay dedicated to something. Mm-hmm. So where we see a lack of church attendance for young kids, I'm hoping that that attendance there has been taken up with some other activity in which they're committed to, that's teaching them life lessons, so be it art or boxing. Mm-hmm. You know, the thought, though, is that, you know, fathers need to teach their children to be committed and to stay focused on something.
I'm impressed with those fathers who are in marriages and who are good role models. I'm also impressed with those who may not be, who may be divorced or single parents, mm-hmm. but who are also committed to their children. Mm-hmm. The other challenge also is for us dads to be nurturing. Mm-hmm. I think that oftentimes it's easier for us to challenge our sons. Mm-hmm. But how nurturing are we to our daughters? Do we teach our daughters some of the skills? You know, do we teach them how to handle mechanical skills? And we tell them what to expect in terms of, my son is in a club of fathers and daughters.
Good.
And they take their daughters out on dates.
Good.
And they tell us what we expect you to occur when you go on a date with a man, when he needs to respect you and do certain kinds of things. And I've gone a couple of times with my granddaughters and really impressed with the fact that these group of young men, they're in the D.C. area, but they actually are committed to their daughters also.
Well, one of the things we saw on that end was that there's this this myth out there that black men tend to walk away from their families, right? But in today's environment, if he's going to get reconnected to a black woman or a female, she normally comes with kids. So, And I say this, you know, because this is the situation, that even if he's not fathering his own kids, he tends to be fathering someone's kids. And so those examples that you're talking about of how to nurture and how to set those models, right, we have to give credit where credit is due. If not my own, then I am doing it for someone else's. And those someone else's tend to become his own. And so he will have multiple families. Don't like to use the word step anything, because family is family. And once they've committed to doing that, they become his kids.
Well, we're almost out of time, but I also want to encourage our viewers to reconnect with the people here. I want to remind you that on Wednesday, there will be a showing of some of the artwork here. That's at Mi Casa Su Casa?
Yes, at 320 Penn Street. It's the artwork of Jafet and Ed Terrell. Is a fundraiser for Jafet. Speak about it.
So the fundraiser is basically, I want to teach young people just like me to go out and do what they want, if it's art, singing, dancing, whatever it is. But there is a lot of young people that I've met out there that like doing art, but they don't know how to show it to people or express what they're doing. So that's basically, I want to open up a youth center to teach young people like me to achieve their goals and dreams.
Good for you. Also, I want to remind my audience that Jafet is also bilingual. He can speak both Spanish and English very well. I want you, if you're interested in boxing, to go to the East Reading Boxing Club.
Absolutely.
Mike is there, and he's giving you the website, mm-hmm. but I hope you can connect there. If you're ever in Harrisburg, you can visit the Newman Memorial Baptist Church.
Thank you.
And if you ever go to Kutztown, you'll run into a dynamic professor in the psychology department, Dr. James Jackson. He's also building future psychologists.
Thank you.
Again, I want to remind our viewers that we like to think that these programs are addressing topics you consider important. And so you're going to see a visual at the end of the program where you can call me or email me about suggestions for future programs. I will tell you that the program in May will be for senior citizens. We'll be talking about senior programs and about people who are reaching out senior audiences and making contributions there. That's important also. I want to take this time also to thank the staff here. We couldn't do this without you, for making this possible. The people who manage, who handle the cameras, who mic us up, and make BCTV a very important part of the community. We couldn't do this without you. We want to thank you. Even though people can't see you, you're here making things happen for us. Gentlemen, if you have any last comments, we're almost out of time. If you have anything you want to say, if you haven't already said, look for a book from Dr. Jackson. He already has a couple out. I use his psychology textbook, and we'll see more things from him in the future. Again,
thank you.
And I want to thank all of you for coming, for making this program possible, and good luck with your artwork in the future. I'm jealous because what you have, you can put your hands on and show it. When you're working with people, they don't always get that kind of feedback, but you get many feedback. Ed, thanks again for all the people you mentor. Murals and many people you mentor to the community. Thanks for watching. Good night. God bless.